you know. Well, Tommy, how should I introduce you?
Just tell him I'm Tommy Chong.
This is Tommy Chong.
And thanks everybody for coming to this free event. Nice, man. New York, this is a great place.
Isn't that beautiful?
And the winter's
what
nice.
A day.
And the winter's nice and you got a job. This is a business.
Yeah. So what a difference an administration makes. It's amazing how things have changed since you, the pre-dawn raid on your house in 2003, a month before the U.S. invaded Iraq. Widely and globally understood now under false pretenses, and at the height of the hubris and at the height of the popularity of the Bush administration, countercultural icon Tommy Chong was targeted in a $12 million sting operation, Operation Pipe Dreams, by a federal prosecutor out of the Western District of Pennsylvania, which some of you may recognize as the sort of the core essence of all things Salem witch hunt oriented. It's sort of long known for that. Rick Santorum, former senator, comes from there. And Mary Beth Buchanan wanted Tommy Chong to do a perp walk for her paraphernalia sting, and spent $12 million doing it. So why do you think she went after you, of all people?
I'm still trying to figure that out. The thing is about being a stoner, you know, we have delayed reactions to everything. I was three months into my sentence before I woke up one night and went, fuck. Because, you know, I was ready. If they're going to bust me for pot, I had my medical card in my pocket. I had my excuses. I had witnesses that proved that I really do have an affliction, you know. But they blindsided me, you know. To be arrested for a bomb, it was not only surprising, but it was embarrassing, you know, because I was in a federal prison with a lot of real criminals, you know. They're murderers or thieves or Republicans or like, and every once in a while they'd ask me, they'd say, what are you in jail for again? And I'd have to put my head down and go, a bong. Then I'd go, it was a big bong, man. It was real big. But the reason they busted me, I guess, I'm guessing, but I'm quite sure I'm right. You know, now that we know how lame or how retarded our president is, you know, they probably thought, you know, they'll take away their bongs, that way they won't be able to smoke their dope. That's all. Either that or they thought that, you know, by putting me in jail, it was a preemptive strike against the hippies, you know, so we wouldn't be on the anti-war trail like we were in Vietnam, during the Vietnam War. It could have been that. It could have been a lot of things, but more than anything, it was really to distract the American people from what was really going on. You know, they were fighting, and now we're finding out what was really going on. They were using every pretense in the world to invade the weakest country, Iraq,
yeah,
for their oil or for whatever purposes.
I wonder now, just in, I mean, the popularity that you're experiencing now, the Cheech and Chong resurgence, the sudden presence of these pots, you know, these stoner comedies all based on Cheech and Chong films in some way, or hat, you know, tipping their hats to Cheech and Chong comedy. If marijuana isn't in some way the new, I don't know if I'm going out there with this, but if marijuana is in some way the new gay marriage, and that it becomes a way to distract people from what's happening in the political arena, or what's happening politically, if it's being used as a distraction, or if it's the consequence of a reality that exists. I mean, people smoke, 80 million people more, you know, smoke marijuana they don't want to be considered criminals for smoking marijuana. Ron Paul Barney Frank just introduced H.R. 8543 in the House of Representatives
to
decriminalize marijuana for personal use, and that's basically what.
The thing is, marijuana is a perfect law for the for the law enforcement people and for the prison population. By the way, the Bureau of Prisons, they love incarcerating marijuana growers and smokers because we're intelligent people, and the first thing the pot criminal does when he's in jail, he makes his surroundings beautiful. And so when I was incarcerated, it was the pot growers that had the gardens looking great, the lawns great. I mean, and were easy to arrest. I was very easy to arrest, you know. They weren't afraid of me, you know. I wasn't some, you know, crazed meth freak with a gun.
They came with 24 fully armed SWAT team commandos to his house that I happen to know. Tommy doesn't even lock his door.
No.
So they can't. I mean, that the level of overkill was just.
But it was embarrassing for them too, you know, because I felt bad for the police that arrested me, because they knew they were totally in the wrong, because they didn't have to do that. They could picked up the phone, called me, and I would have went down. And, you know, you know, said whatever, you know. Even that's what I did when I went to jail. I pled guilty. Yeah, I'll go to jail. Whatever, you know. Because I know that I wasn't doing anything wrong. You know, I'm not a criminal. And people that grow pot and people that sell pot, they're not criminals either. You know, what we're doing. In fact, what pot is really doing, and you've got to remember this, you know, the American economy is in the shitter right now. I mean, it's right down. But for some reason, America is still vibrant. There's still things being bought and sold and manufactured. And then you look at other statistics that say that marijuana is the number one cash crop in the world, in America, in the world. That means people that are growing pot are growing money that's not taxed in any way, other than, you know, criminals, but it's not being taxed. And people that, you know, that deal in the pot economy, they can't put that cash into savings and bonds and that. They have to spend it. And so what happens, you've got this vibrant economy going thanks to the pot, and also thanks to the fact that it's illegal, because it's illegal now, it costs more than cigarettes, basically. You know, I mean, the marijuana is, the price is, what, $85 an eighth or something?
All I know is that you could, to fill your car with a tank of gas, you could buy an eighth of weed.
Yeah.
And that's criminal.
Yeah. So anyway, the government knows this. And the government, I learned this in prison, the government is knee-deep in the drug business, both on the incarceration side. They incarcerate all these people for drug offenses for no good reason. And plus, the government, and this is what I was told in prison by people that really knew, the DEA has a free fly zone everywhere in the world. They don't have to answer to any customs. They don't have to go through anybody. No one checks on the DEA. And they have daily flights out of Colombia into America. And no one checks the cargo, for one. No one checks the cops, in other words. There's nobody checking on the DEA. I've had pot dealers that got arrested. And they went into their safe houses and they took $500,000 in one instance. And then they took the pothead and they just kicked them out. They said, get out of here. That never hit the papers, that never hit any records. DEA, in this one instance, just one, walked away with $500,000 in cash and probably more in weed, which they sell. So it wasn't the United States government per se that put me in jail. It was the drug dealers that worked for the government that had me arrested. And it was a showcase. It's a showcase to show, yeah, we're really spending all this billions of dollars to fight drugs. There you go. We put Tommy Chong, the pothead, you know, with a bomb. We got him in jail. We took him off the streets. In the meantime, while everybody's looking at the bong maker in jail, the real drug dealers, which is the arm of the United States, the DEA, the drug enforcement agencies, they're the real drug dealers. And Ollie North, during that Ollie North period, they proved that. There's proof out there. And there's proof right now. But what are you going to do? You know, and you gotta think that if the DEA is involved in all this multi-billion-dollar organization, that a lot of that money is going into the other areas of the government, such as the vice president area, the president himself. You know, there's so much corruption.
Oh, and there's a lot of agencies that have their hand in the till, and that makes it difficult to effectively reform marijuana laws. It's going to be tough because there was a recent raid on the backer of the documentary, which you can also get at the table with the book. His warehouse was raided in Kentucky by the same prosecutor that went after Tommy Chong. The target was an $80 million drug testing industry. It's a cottage industry that rose up to counterbalance the $5.9 billion GlaxoSmithKline led drug testing agency that creates these drug tests. And this small cottage industry rose up to basically fill a niche, fill an opening in the economy.
Well, to help people keep their jobs.
Right.
If you got a job, say, at Home Depot, and you get drug tested,
insurance companies lobby to make sure Home Depot tests their employees.
Yeah.
For marijuana, and when I was talking to Tommy's federal defense attorney in Pittsburgh for the bond case paraphernalia, he's now defending the manufacturer of the Wizinator, which was the same prosecutor.
Tell me what a Wizinator is.
It's a 3.5-inch prosthetic penis that comes in 5 natural skin tones. It urinates synthetic urine that's used by people that are being drug tested.
And there's a disclaimer on it, the penises, not to be used by women.
Yeah.
Because they might get suspicious. First of all, let me tell you, when they drug test you, the federal agent has to watch you take out your penis and pee.
Tommy was piss tested for a year, every single Thursday. Or was it every 2 weeks or something like that? The formal drug testing. You weren't even arrested on a drug-related charge. It was drug paraphernalia, and yet you had to register as a drug offender, and then you had to piss test.
This was
for a probation officer. You had to drive to the valley to some office, sign autographs,
and they play pee in a cup. And they play games with you, you know, because this is, you know, some of the Fed, one of the worst jobs is having to watch some guy pee. You know, these are macho guys, and all of a sudden they got to stand there and look at your dick while you're peeing.
Well, this 80.
And after a while, you get used to it. After a while, you kind of just show me, hey, what do you think of this? What do you think of this? Can you see it? There you go.
I think that's why they arrested you, because they wanted to see you naked. Because every time you got a visitor at Taft, you had to take your clothes off.
Yeah.
Bend over and cough.
When you're in the federal lockup, you have to get strip searched. And then they make you squat and cough. That's the thing. Just in case you got something in your bum. You know. But you have to think, you know, what if the guy has to go to the bathroom? It's not a pretty thing.
You can't make it up. But when I was talking to Stan Levinson, and I asked him, I said, well, this has got to be the twitching of the dinosaur tail. They're just going after the piss testing industry now. And he said, no, he thinks it's going to persist because the IRS, they have their money to exact, the DEA, the different agencies that exist separate from, you know, from the presidential races. The president appoints the attorney general, and the attorney general appoints prosecutors like Mary Beth Buchanan. So Ashcroft appointed and Bush appointed Mary Beth Buchanan, and then they go after you. But shifting the conversation a little bit back to what's happening right now with Cheech and Chong, there's a counterculture that you guys represent, and you in many respects, you know, we go back 20 years. You're you're a musician. You know, a lot of times Dave Chappelle said, you know, when we were in Aspen, that being a comedian and being a musician are very similar, you know, intentions within a person and the same, I guess, poetic intention. And when you first started doing comedy, they didn't even know you could talk, a lot of the people that knew Tommy. When you and Cheech came down to California from Vancouver, you know, to sort of sharpen your teeth on the stage as comedians, what was it about the culture that you were representing that made you the icon of marijuana that you are? Because in many ways, and you said this yourself, who you're perceived as and who you really are, it's a weird mix in the Venn diagram of who you really are. But a lot of the way people perceive you as this, you know, the hemp messiah or this icon of marijuana is really because you represent a culture, and then you and Cheech represented this culture and became incredibly popular because this culture wasn't being spoken to, and this mass of people that had come up through the 60s and were altered and revolutionized by the thinking and the countercultural this movement created these pigeons.
He's on pot. I'll cut to the chase.
Saved by the pigeon.
Cheech and I, the reason we're so successful is that Cheech and I played two characters that everybody could look down on, much like Chaplin did. Charlie Chaplin, that's why he became the tramp or the homeless guy, because everybody felt good when they watched him. And Cheech and Chong, we represent every man. Everybody knows a Cheech and Chong. It could be their dad, an uncle, or their brother, someone. Everybody knows. And we're two brown guys. And what we did, actually, we sort of eliminated racism in a way where I'm a Canadian. So I've never, Cheech was the first Mexican I'd ever met. And he was fascinating. I wanted to go up and touch him. and that's the way Canadians were with black people too. You know, we had six black people in Calgary when I grew up, and I married one of them because I was fascinated. You know, that's what it is when you're not around them, you get fascinated. And so what Cheech and I really represented, we represented everybody, you know, who is fascinated by, you know, things that, you know, taboo things like race and so on. And so one of the reasons Cheech and I were so far, and then we found out pot is a great equalizer. That's what Woodstock was such a great success. It wasn't because of the music, it wasn't because of the people, it was because of the pot. Pot mellowed everybody out. And you don't think of color when you take a toke and you go to pass it. You don't, oh, it's a black guy, better not pass it to him. No, you pass it to everybody because that's your common bond. And that's why Cheech and I have been so popular for all these years, is that not only we represent the lowest of the low in America, but we also use pot as our great common denominator. And that's why we're so popular.
He's on pot too. So it's shocking to
no. Keep the question short.
So how did it happen? How did after all these years, you and Cheech and the estrangement and the differences and the Don Johnsons and the born in East LA.
Sure.
How did you fall in love again?
Cheech and I?
Yeah.
Again, it's a pot. Pot cures all. We broke up at the height of our career. And the universe is perfect. So there was a reason why we broke up. Regardless if I was sad or he was sad, whatever. Doesn't matter. We broke up at the height of our career. Had we not broken up 30 years ago, we would not be getting together today to do a reunion. We would have been burned out, people would have forgot about us, but the fact that we broke up at the right time, and then we went 30 years without being on stage together, now we're back together, and it's like a brand new start, and everybody's excited about it because all they've had all these years is, you know, the Up in Smoke, and people have seen it so many times, they know it by heart. Now, we're going to get another shot at it again, and we're going to get new energy. Cheech went on, and he did his career with Nash Bridges, became a good actor. He had a life. I went on stage, became a stand-up comedian. I got my wife into stand-up. So everything happens for a reason, and this is what I see, is that had we not broken up, we wouldn't be able to get together again, and it wouldn't have meant anything. And now it means something, and it also comes at a time when it's like we're ushering in a new era. You know, we're actually kind of going back to the 60s, but we're not really. We're in the 60s, we never had cell phones, we never had computers, we never had any of that stuff. Now we're into the computer age, and Cheech and Chong, and the pot, bigger than ever. I tell people this, man, there wouldn't be computers if it wasn't for pot. And another thing, remember this, man. The DNA. DNA is what's a binary system, 0 and 1.
Well, the double helix.
Yeah, there's a system. It's kind of freaky. When I was in jail, I got hooked into a book called the I Ching, which is a book of changes. The book of changes was written 5,000 years ago. Yeah, 5,000 years ago,
by a
Chinese guy named King Wen, who was put in jail by the emperor because he was more powerful than the emperor. He could tell people's fortunes, more or less, and tell the future with this book of changes, the I Ching. When I was in prison, my brother-in-law sent me a copy of the I Ching. And when I threw the coins and I opened the book, it said, "You are in jail for a reason." Yeah. I looked at that book, I couldn't believe it. You are in jail for a reason. And then it said, jails are corrective institutions where you go to correct your attitude. And I went, and that's what I did. I had to correct my attitude. And it became a positive force. But it also turned me on to the I Ching. And then I give everybody I Ching's readings. That was my job in jail. After that, was people come by and get readings from the I Ching. So if you're not familiar with the I Ching, there's a book by Carol K. Anthony. That's, to me, is the best book. Get it, read it, do it. And believe me, it'll change your life. Because what it does, this is the point. The I Ching is based on odd and even, 0 and 1. The computer system is based on the same system, 0 and 1. Our DNA is based on the same system, 0 and 1. And it seems like it's the invisible and the visible. And so that's what I learned, and that's what's been driving me, and that's what helped me write a book. And everybody's here for an individual reason. There's no, this is the way you should do something, this is the way you should look, this is the way you should think. No. Everybody has to find that out for themselves. Everybody. And not only that, then I got hooked up with the sweat lodge. In prison, the Native Americans who have been in prison since Columbus ended up on, you know, discovered this place called America. The white man, you know, the first thing they do is to eliminate all the Native people. And they said that America was empty when they discovered it. No, it's full of Native people. And Native people are a lot of the population in prisons today where the Native people. But they petitioned to get their religion, which is the sweat lodge. And I joined the sweat lodge, and the sweat lodge is incredible. And they gave me this when I left. It's a medicine bag. And I learned everything I needed to learn about spirituality. But I'll give you just one. And the Native people believe that everything on earth is sacred. The air we breathe, the dirt, the rocks, everything is sacred. And what they do in the sweat lodge, they heat the rocks until the rocks become alive. The rocks are dormant until they heat it. And the rocks become red hot. And when they put the rocks in the center of the sweat lodge, that symbolizes the center of the universe. And that when you sit in the lodge, only the chief is allowed to speak. And then they chant ancient Lakota chants, and you sit there. And I want to tell you, the first time I did it, I had the wrong impression. I thought it was like a sauna. You're going to sit there and bullshit and have a good time. Not like that at all. You sweat. What you do, you actually have to surrender. You cannot stand that heat unless you totally surrender. And that's what I had to do. Everybody has to do, is surrender. And I felt my spirit rise out of my body, but it wasn't my spirit, it was my ego. Because that's why the native people sweat. Because what the problem with this world today comes from ego. And that's why women should, in my estimation, should be the rulers. Because women somehow don't have egos. At least the ones, you know, that I know of. My wife, for instance. Men have egos. And what an ego is, the ego is the false sense of who we think we have to be in order to exist in the world. And this is why the native people would sweat before they would go into battle. Because you could not go into battle. And the ego is consisted entirely of fear. And the native people would never go into battle with fear. They could never do that. So they would go in the sweat. They would sweat out the ego until the ego disappeared. And then they could go into battle, because what they would learn, what you learn in the sweat lodge, is that we are eternal. We have been here forever. We will always be here forever. Only difference is we come in different forms according to what we need to learn in every existence that we come back into. And the native people, when they would learn this, then they could go into battle totally fearless, but they wouldn't have to necessarily kill their enemy. Sometimes, many times, all they would have to do is walk up to their enemy and touch him on the chest just to show them that they were fearless. And that's why they called the native people brave, because they were brave. And you can't be brave if you've got any fear inside of you. And so that's why they would sweat. And that's what I learned. I learned in prison, and that's why I went to prison too. I had to learn these things. And I learned that we are eternal. We have always been here. And it always kills me when people say, they talk about the Big Bang Theory. Okay, the Big Bang Theory is all of a sudden there's a big explosion and then the universe was created. Yeah, okay. What was before the Big Bang? There's more Big Bangs. Eternity is that. Eternity is eternity. There's infinity is infinity. Perfection. You know, what's that, with the pyrs, what's the formula for
pi r squared? 2 pi r squared?
Anyway, it goes on to infinity. It goes on to infinity. That's the definition of the world. It never ends. It's not perfect. It can't be perfect. If it was perfect, there would be an ending. So it's imperfect. The world we live in is imperfect. It has to be. We're imperfect. We have to be. If we're too perfect, we can't exist on this earth. And that's what I learned. And that's what I learned, how to look at everybody and everything. You look at it, there's only one connection. Again, that's where the pot came in. The connection is love. The love. Just like I learned that there's no night and day. Darkness is only the absence of light. Think of that. Evil is only the absence of good. Think of that. And if you want to exist, you want to exist anywhere, especially in prison, all you have to do is go to that spot in your consciousness. In your consciousness. Just think about it. We're one thought away from heaven. You want to be in heaven? All you have to do is think of it. When you think of heaven, when you think of the good, when you think of God, for a better word, then evil does not exist. And then you can take that even further. You can take that into disease. That's how people have been healed for centuries, without doctors. They've had cancers in the old days. They had worse diseases in the old days. But the way they cured them, and that's why Jesus came. It wasn't to cure everybody. It was to show us how to cure ourselves. It was a knowledge. And that's what we, that's the advantage that we have over people before. They're here and they're gone so fast. I've got a 2-year-old grandson now. I got a 27-year-old grandson. And I got 40-year-old daughters. I mean, where did it go? They were little bitty kids a minute ago. Now they're grown. So enjoy them while you got them, because you're not going to have them for long.
Any other questions?
Yes, sir.
Did you share the story when you met John Lennon?
Yeah, I met John Lennon. Actually, I got hired with every Beatle except Paul. Ringo wouldn't smoke. Ringo was a recovering alcoholic, so sorry, Mike. George and I, we smoked up quite a bit. George Harrison, he's an old guitar player, so we had a good time. I met John Lennon in when Cheech and I first started, back in, I guess, 71, 72. It was at a party, and I went into a bedroom to smoke a joint, and I thought I was alone. And when I lit it up, I looked over, and John Lennon was sitting on the floor. And I offered him a toke, and he said, "No, no thanks, I've got immigration problems." Okay, John, okay. Sorry, I was a fan. You know, I was going to bug him. Hey, so how come you guys broke up? But I never. I respected his privacy. It was nice. I was in a room with a Beatle. It was great. And then I turned and looked over, and oh, Rod Stewart walks in. And Rod's in the mirror, you know, puffing his hair up. With that hair. And it's real hair, too. I always thought it was a wig, but it's real hair. And he's in there doing his hair thing. I offered him a joint. It was the same joint. And he goes, "Oh, no, thanks, man. I got my throat. You got to worry about my throat." And I was feeling kind of weird. You know? No one wanted to get high. Okay. Then I walked out the door, and I ran into Jack Nicholson. And I'm stoned now. I'm stoned. And I see Jack, and Jack is a very private guy. And he looked at me like I was, you know, he's trying to get around me, you know. And he was just praying I wouldn't talk to him. I go, Jack, I just saw you on the movies, man. And then, and he wouldn't talk back. He wouldn't say anything. And so I got nervous. I started talking. I said, "Hey, I really like the movie. I like that part where you're in the mirror and you're combing your hair, you know." I said, "Was that improv? Did you improv it?" And he still wouldn't answer me. He's just staring at me, you know. Then I said, of course, you know, when people do that, you say the stupidest thing. I said, "Yeah, you're combing your hair, and you don't have any hair." And, okay.